Thank you all for joining us on the Unify Global Summit. Today we're joined by the co-founder and CEO of the Food Revolution Network. With over 350,000 members, the Food Revolution Network aims to empower individuals, build community, and transform food systems. Ocean serves as an adjunct professor for Chapman University. He's the recipient of the National Jefferson Award for Outstanding Public Service, among many other awards. And he's the author of The Power of Partnership and co-author of Voices of the Food Revolution, as well as Choices for Our Future. Ocean, hey, thanks so much for being with us, man.
I'm thrilled to be with you and thrilled to be able to be with the audience of amazing people that have gathered here together.
Absolutely. So today we're talking about how to bring health and healing to your life and to the planet and to your community around you. So, Ocean, I want to ask you first, what inspired you to write the book Voices of the Food Revolution, and what are some of your key takeaways from co-authoring that book?
Well, what inspired me to write that book was we had just finished a Food Revolution Summit where my dad and colleague, best-selling author John Robbins, and I interviewed some of the top food experts on the planet, and I thought that what they had to say was scintillating, it was game-changing, and it needed to be shared more widely. So we took a lot of those interviews and kind of distilled them into a book format and then created that as a compilation and brought that to the world. And I think that the core issue here is that there's a lot of confusion about food, amongst the population. We hear one day that fat's bad and one day that fat's good, and we hear that animal proteins are bad for us and we hear that they're good for us, and we hear that we need milk for strong bones, and then we hear that the countries where the people drink the most milk have the highest rates of osteoporosis. And we hear all this conflicting information. We hear GMOs are the spawn of Satan, and then we hear that they're totally fine and have been proven to be perfect and can help feed a hungry world. And a lot of people are confused. And what happens in confusion is that we don't take decisive action. And so the status quo ultimately kind of prevails. And what we have is a status quo that is toxic, that is lethal, that is taking the lives of millions of people every year. We have a status quo in which it's considered normal to eat food that is promoting of cancer and heart disease and diabetes and osteoporosis and Alzheimer's disease, and we're paying a devastating price for our toxic food system. We've got a medical system that, for the most part, acts as if food didn't matter, while it focuses on high-tech treatment of diseases that didn't have to happen in the first place. And we've got a food system that, for the most part, acts like health didn't matter, as it focuses on profits and the almighty dollar over our health and the health of our planet. So in this context, it is imperative that we, the people, become informed, become empowered, and become agents of our own destinies, because the status quo is, I think, unacceptable. And so what we've seen in the Food Revolution Network, which I founded with my dad, is that there's actually kind of a consensus. That there is a very solid body of medical research from thousands upon thousands of medical studies published in peer-reviewed scientific journals that all essentially point us in the same direction. And like with climate change, where there may be a few scientists who are outliers, 99% agree. And the same is true with food and health, that there is an overwhelming body of evidence about the vast majority of the things that we need to do if we want to move in a healthy direction. And the confusion is to some extent manufactured.
Yeah, let me ask you right there real quick, because I can sense that, and I know certainly it's been true for me in the past, that you think of status quo and you think of, well, everybody eats hamburgers at McDonald's, or everybody eats drive-thru, or this, and I've been eating it for 20 years and it doesn't bother me. I'm not sick. I don't have disease or this or that. So why should any of this matter to me in the first place? If everyone else is doing it and the FDA approves it, doesn't that mean it should be okay for me, right?
That's right. Thank you for raising that point, because that's the logic, that's the fallacy that that many of us fall prey to. Here's the thing: it is normal in our society that more than half of the people who reach the age of 85 have Alzheimer's. It is normal in our society that cancer takes the lives of huge numbers of people, and in fact, 1 in 3 women and 1 in 2 men will get cancer in their lifetime. it is normal in our society that heart disease is like a fact of life, and it's the number one cause of death. And we've taken it as normal that that hospitalizations for food allergies have tripled in the last 20 years amongst our kids. We take it as normal now that one in 50 kids has autism. We take it as normal that more and more people are living chronically sick, that two-thirds of our population is overweight or obese. And yet, this is not normal. This is not how our bodies were designed to thrive. They are exquisite at being able to fight disease and regenerate and replenish and have the energy that we need, the mental clarity that we need to go through the day vibrant and alive and powerful. But we have taken on a way of eating that has become normalized, that's killing us slowly, but surely. And when you look at the cultures in the world where people live the longest and healthiest lives, they've been dubbed blue zones by National Geographic. And these are places where people live on average about 10 years longer than in the United States, but their healthy years, maybe 20 more, because they inhabit their days to the very end. They don't die in nursing homes, decrepit and miserable and suffering after years and years of surgeries and struggles and watching their vitality slip away. They die at a ripe old age, having lived a full, abundant, beautiful life. And we've looked at the peoples that have lived the longest, healthiest lives in the world and that still do to this day. And we ask, what can we learn from them? And guess what? They're all over the world, but they all have one thing in common. They all get lots of exercise, but they also eat a predominantly whole foods, plant-strong diet. Not necessarily strictly vegan, but plant-strong. The vast majority of their calories come from plants. And I think we could learn a little something from these communities. And one of them is right here in the United States, in Loma Linda, California, where the Seventh-day Adventists practice a predominantly plant-strong whole foods diet and get a lot of exercise. They also have strong social connections. And there are some other things that you see in these cultures as well that we could also do well to learn from. But when you think about what is it worth to have, you know, 10 or 20 more years of vital health in your life, you know, it's, I think a lot of people who are struggling with mortality would do anything to add a few more years to love their kids, or to be able to dance at their grandchildren's wedding, or to be able to take care of business that they don't feel like they're ready to go yet. And when people are at that point, they would spend any amount of money. They'd drive their family into bankruptcy just to have a shot at survival. But we won't do the simple things day by day. We say that broccoli's too expensive, and we forget that chemotherapy's kind of expensive as well, right? And so my interest is in helping us to rewire our brains so that we cease to see normal as acceptable, and we come to see normal as toxic, and then we create a new normal. We create habits and norms and culture and ecosystems and environments that support us in having, I think, the vitality and the joy that is our birthright.
So I totally agree. I actually published an article years ago that was addressing that same point, because I realized that, yeah, we came to this. I mean, it was that awareness for me for the first time that, yeah, we think being sick and having all these diseases is normal, but it's not. It is normal, but it's not natural. It's not a part of what we're, let's say, supposed to experience or could be experiencing as a collective, right? We all have the potential, the capacity, and the ability to experience complete and whole and fulfilling health and vitality, basically pretty much in most cases until the day we die. And that's true in a lot of these blue zones, and it's true in a lot of personal biographies and stories you can read of people who are healthy till the day they were 90, and then when they were 91, they said, I've lived my life, I'm leaving, thank you, goodbye, and they choose to leave their body versus leaving their body but without choice because of some disease or some therapy that actually caused them to leave their body. So I think that's such a critical point, number one, that health is health, complete health is natural and should be normal. And number two, you talk about exercise, and I think you said in the blue zones, one of the things they do is exercise all the time. Now, I think what happens, at least here in America, is that people who know that they should exercise, specifically people who, you know, are obese or overweight or just busy, right? And they know they should exercise, but they don't because they think they have to do too much. Yeah. What kind? You say these people do a lot of exercise. Do you know about how much exercise is a lot, or how much exercise is needed?
Well, what's interesting is that when you actually look at their lifestyles, most of them have built it into their lives in a way that they don't go to the gym to exercise. They don't go do their workout and then sit at their desk all day. In general, these cultures are places where people are out and about a lot. Their lives require moving. They are on foot as they go shopping. A lot of them live in close-knit communities and they travel about. And so the point there, I think, is probably from a cardiovascular perspective, that it's not just one moment and then sitting all day. I think some people say sitting is the new smoking, because there are a lot of studies showing that when you sit for 10, 12, 14 hours a day, over time, it doesn't just impact your spine and your skeletal structure, but it actually impacts your heart, because your body was meant to move. It was meant to be alive. And, you know, if you don't use it, you lose it, right? That's true of muscular power, but it's also true of cardiovascular circulation. The blood flow that your heart sends through your whole body also goes to your brain. And that movement keeps things alive and vital and dynamic, and it flushes out toxins, and it helps your body to use its capacities to the fullest. And as you age, you don't if you don't use your muscles and your blood to its capacity, and your veins and your arteries to their capacity, over time an inertia sets in, and it gets harder and harder to get moving. So what I think a lot of these cultures have done is created lives where they move by default, because
most of them grow a lot of their own food as well, right?
Yeah, exactly.
So they're outside moving pretty much every day.
Yeah, totally. And now, you know, and I think it was Mahatma Gandhi who spoke eloquently about how we all need to use our heads and our hands for optimal health, right? And if you get too out of balance in one direction or the other, you compromise your well-being. And what we've got is a society where certain people are doing manual labor all day for the rest of us, and then some of us are doing sort of mental labor all day for the rest of us, and those are important functions. I think for optimal vitality and joy, most of us need a certain balance, right? And now, of course, you may be sitting there looking at this thinking, well, gosh, I work a desk job. I have to be at a desk all day. And that's true about me, quite honestly. I'm at the desk a lot. But here's some of the ways I build in movement. I take little dance breaks. I put a little song on and just kind of groove around the room for 5 minutes every so often, right? And I come back to work refreshed and present and vital and more available for life. I hang out with my kids, and I literally will dance while I'm doing the dishes, or I will jog from room to room. And while I'm doing it, I'm kind of skipping. And there's just a feeling of like just building my vitality and aliveness, right? And then I have times I go work out at the gym. I bike when I can instead of driving to appointments that are local. And so I'm just building in, you know, it takes an extra 5 or 10 minutes, but I also get my day's exercise, right? And I get movement, and I actually love being out in the sunshine and experiencing, you know, nature around me. So these are ways that you can kind of just think about building in movement and vitality and letting it become part of your habits.
So you're in a unique position because you've also had the opportunity to interview and spend quality time with some of the top medical doctors and scientists and neuroscience researchers in the world and ask them a lot of these questions about health and healing and plant-based and exercise and all of that. And so what's one, in terms of plant-based diet and plant-based living, if you will, or plant-strong diet, are a lot of these medical doctors and scientists also agreeing that a plant-based diet is actually what's going to help you live a lot longer?
Yeah, I mean, I think there is an overwhelming body of research that tells us in pretty much no uncertain terms that the optimal diet for human beings compared to where we are now is a lot less sugar, a lot less processed carbs, a lot less, you know, perhaps even no white flour. And we also want to move away from bottled oils, from chemical flavorings, preservatives, additives, you know, processed junk, stuff we don't know the names of, right? Don't know how to pronounce. Towards whole real foods. We also know pretty conclusively that we want to eat more whole fruits and vegetables. I'm not talking about fruit juice. I'm talking about real whole foods that have the fiber and the whole plant involved, right? And then the data is pretty darn clear that people do better when they eat whole grains and legumes. And the data is also pretty clear that people do better statistically when they eat little or no processed meats. And broadly speaking, animal products are associated with negative health outcomes. Now, that's not to say all animal products ever necessarily, but broadly speaking, I think we would do well to eat a lot less meat, a lot less dairy products than is the norm today. Now, does that mean you should be exclusively vegan? Perhaps for some people, yes. Perhaps for some people, not necessarily, depending on their ethics, their value system, their ecosystem, their health history, your metabolism, your stage of life, all different factors come into play. For some people, it seems that wild fish can have some beneficial properties from a purely health perspective if the ethics work for you. But I think the direction is clear. And it's towards a more plant-centered diet with a lot more whole fruits and vegetables. And, you know, when I talk about legumes and grains, I know a lot of people in the paleo crowd are not excited about legumes and grains. And yet, I think the data is such that they're wonderful sources of fiber, which is something that less than 5% of the U.S. population gets enough of. And they're wonderful. Legumes are a great source of plant-based protein. And there's a lot of vitamins and minerals in there. And so does that mean everybody should eat grains or legumes? Not necessarily. You have to listen to your body and your wisdom. Some people have gut issues that they need to try something out, try a radical detox diet, and then add foods in one by one and see how it works for you. But for the vast majority of the population, the data is clear that legumes and whole grains are associated with reduced incidence of diabetes and heart disease and cancer and obesity and with higher health outcomes across the board. Not for everybody necessarily, but for most people. So those are my broad senses based on interviewing a lot of people and looking at a lot of medical studies over the course of many, many years.
Well, you said something that was really quickly said that I think is that I resonate a lot with, because it's exactly what I did back in around, I don't know, 2007 was when I did my first cleanse, and I did a 5-day, and I was eating meat and still drinking a little bit of alcohol, and I was eating a lot of processed food, and I was on a healthier path. I stopped eating fast food and stopped drinking soda and that sort of thing, but a lot of greasy food, you know, a lot of sugar, all of that. But I did a 5-day master cleanse just out of intuition. I had a friend that's like, I'm doing this cleanse. I'm like, I knew nothing of what, I didn't even know what cleanse meant. And I was like, all right, I'll do it too. So I did 5 days, which is basically eliminating. Anyone who doesn't know, it's like you eliminate all your, everything you normally do, food, alcohol, smoking if it is or whatever. And you're just cleansing. Yeah. You're letting your body clean out. I did that for 5 days, and while it was tough and I struggled through it, I got to the end of it. And at the end of it, I felt like I knew the inside of my body for the first time.
Yeah.
I felt like I had this newfound relationship with my organs, and like they were, I felt as if they could speak, they were literally thanking me for that cleanse. And it all of a sudden set me on this trajectory of really wanting to understand, you know, what is it that gives vitality and energy to our body? Because you can't really see what's going on inside, right? And a lot of times, especially people with a high metabolism, can eat really horrible, and they don't get obese or overweight, and they look fine on the outside, right? But they don't know what's going on the inside. So, because you said that, sometimes that's what it takes. You need to go to like an extreme cleanse or diet shift for a period of time, and then just pay attention to what's going on inside your body, and pay attention to the things that that feel good to your body that you start putting in it after you finish that cleanse. Because that, you know, eventually put me into a totally plant-based diet myself. And, and I think that was a big door opener for me.
Yeah. Well, here's what we've got to do. We've got to be able to reclaim our ability to trust our own instincts. And for the most part, many of us our instincts have been hijacked by a food industry that is looking out for its profits, not for our health. And they've created addictive foods. And many of us confuse impulses and body wisdom with addiction. You know, you see something, you smell something, you think about something, and you salivate. And some part of you says, I want that. And sometimes we're wanting things that are not in our own best interests. But the ability to reattune to your body's primal nature and your body's wisdom, your body's ability to know what you want so that you feel instinctively drawn to some things that are actually good for you is one of the most powerful and liberating forces available to us. And we have to sometimes clear away the clutter. It's like it's going to be very hard for somebody who is in a drug addiction cycle to know whether or not the drug to which they are addicted is good for them based on listening to their own body's instincts. Because they're like, oh, I want it, I want it, I want it, right? But when they get clear, when they can break out of that cycle, then they can attune to a wisdom that says, oh, I know that's not good for me, right? Even though I have a part of me that craves it, I also know it's not good for me, and I'm going to be in my own integrity and not choose that path, right? And so similarly, I think around food, when we detoxify, and sometimes we need some bright lines. Like sometimes we need to be able to say no, not ever. Like for a lot of people, they need that around sugar. Like just straight up no added sugars. Try it for a month even. And if it's hard, then you got to keep going. That's the fact of it. The only time when you should have sugar as a regular part of your life in any kind of consistent basis is when you don't need it at all. Right? When it's like, oh yeah, I can, and then it's just a little bit and you don't want to do more. You don't eat the whole package of cookies. You might have one cookie just because it's fun and you're connecting with somebody and you're interested. Oh yeah, that's delicious. And then you're done. But if you're like, oh, I need this, then that's the time when you might need a bright line. Like an alcoholic cannot have one drink, right? If you're in AA, you do zero. That's and you have count your days of sobriety. And I think we need to treat sugar addiction in a similar way. I mean, scientists are telling us sugar is more addictive than cocaine, right? And that is actually true. And it's probably a lot more destructive than cocaine as well. When you look at its impact on our society as a whole, the average American eats 66 pounds of added sugar per year, more than 2 tons in a lifetime, enough to fill a commercial dumpster, right? And what is that doing?
And when you look at the back of anything you buy that's packaged and it says sugars, and everything else has a percentage except sugar, and it might say 6 grams or 8 grams or 12 grams, and then you read the amount per serving, right? And it's like people don't realize it's like, oh, 12 grams. Oh, that, you know, that's fine, right? Because it doesn't tell you the percent. If it told you the percentage of 12 grams of sugar, it would probably tell you like 280% or something, right? I don't know the exact math.
Well,
but even 12 grams is a massive amount of added sugar to your diet outside of what you would normally get from like fruits and vegetables, yeah?
Right, sure. Well, that's because there's a recommended allowance, but there is no recommended allowance for sugar because the science is clear that we're best off with zero, right? Yeah. Now, there is a difference, I want to say, between added sugars and sugars that are just natively present in whole foods. Like with fruit, for example. Whole fruit. The studies show that even most people with diabetes can actually eat large amounts of whole fruit without consequence. Now, obviously, that's not medical advice. Talk to your doctor, listen to your body, follow your own experience. But studies show that it's frequently fine. And there are tremendous benefits to whole fruits in terms of all the fiber and all the vitamins and minerals, and they're associated with a whole host of positive health outcomes. So I think that but fruit juice concentrate or even fruit juice is a whole other thing. That's like going, you know, that's like mainlining the drug straight into your eye as an IV, you know?
There's no fiber to help it to process, right?
Right.
So, yeah, exactly. You're just sucking down the sugar, absolutely.
Yeah. Now, that doesn't mean, did you want to put a little bit of juice in some sparkling water for a fun beverage once in a while? Fine. But don't base your life around it.
Right. And it also makes, I want to add to that point, I think, because what I've come to experience is that it makes a huge difference if you are exercising, because you can burn off those sugars a lot faster, you know?
Sure.
And I notice a huge difference in my own energy levels going back to exercise, because I'm like you. I mean, a lot of the work I do is mind-related work at a computer, sitting multiple hours a day. One of the big changes I've made recently is, one is I'm starting a small farm, so it's forcing me to get myself outside growing food. And I've committed myself to it. And two is I've started training for an ultra marathon, and I've never ran before in my life other than, you know, sports growing up. So I just started running a couple of months ago. And so that's forcing me to get into, you know, 3-4 days a week of dedicated exercise.
Yeah.
The big difference I've noticed, I mean, I've always been active my whole life, but the big difference I've noticed lately is, you know, if I sat in a meeting for 3 or 4 hours, you know, doing interviews, having discussions, you know, a really intense in-person meeting with a group of people, I might feel a little drained from that. But lately in those types of meetings, I leave there and I'm still full of energy, you know, and it's like I could go out and have 3 more meetings. I could go for another 12 hours, like no problem. And so it's a really, really, I just want to add that to the exercise part, continuing to find ways, commit yourself to something so that it forces you to get outside and do some level of exercise. And then if you do have a little extra sugar from fruit juice or something, your body's going to burn it really quickly anyway. But not if you eat a whole bag of cookies and 12 donuts and a giant thing of pasta, right? Unless you're really doing a lot of exercise. Anyway.
That's right. And there are some really powerful superfoods that I want to mention as well, because we focus a lot on the bad stuff, but I like to crowd out the bad stuff with the good stuff. And
we're going to take a quick break. There's a couple messages here to share with our listeners, and I want you to share that as soon as we get back.
All right. Superfoods coming right up.
Festival in New Mexico. Beautiful gathering in its first year. I can't even imagine what it will be like next year.
This weekend has been one of the most magical experiences of my festival career.
I still feel like I haven't explored enough after 3 days, so it was awesome.
It has been the most inspiring and heart-centered festival I have ever been to.
Okay, we are back here with Ocean Robbins, CEO and co-founder of the Food Revolution Network, and we're having a fascinating conversation on health and healing. Ocean's about to talk about some of these superfoods that, that we all really should know about.
Yeah. So first of all, to me, a superfood is not some $300 a pound ginseng or some fancy goji berry from the Himalayas that's only available to the super elite. Right, I'm interested in foods that are super precisely because they can make the biggest difference to the largest number of people. And so in that light, let me share a few facts with you. So mushrooms, a study done of over 4,000 women conducted by researchers at the University of New Zealand found that women who consumed the equivalent to about 3 button mushrooms per day had a 64% drop in breast cancer risk over the course of 20 years. 3 mushrooms a day. We're not talking about a huge quantity, right? And these were button mushrooms. I mean, you know, not like some fancy shiitake or maitake or chanterelle. And those are wonderful too. But mushrooms are incredibly healing in their power. Number two, when those same women consumed green tea, an average of at least a cup a day of green tea, their risk of breast cancer dropped by 89%. 89%. Now, how many lives could be saved just with regular consumption of mushrooms and green tea? Like massive. The implications are profound, right? So those are two of my favorites. There are also studies showing tremendous health benefits from a couple of vices, and I'm talking about red wine and chocolate here, and also coffee. All three of those have been directly linked to consuming more of them equals lower rates of dementia in particular and Alzheimer's disease, as well as cancer and diabetes and heart issues.
Ocean, let me ask you on that, because I've seen studies on both sides of that picture, and I've chosen to, I used to do like a glass of wine, sometimes 2 glasses of wine a day, convincing myself that it was healthy, as well as coffee and chocolate. And now pretty much those things are, coffee's been eliminated for years, chocolate maybe once a month, once every 2 months, and red wine, I don't know, that's been probably 6, 7, 8 months since I've had a glass. Yeah. What I found in my body is it feels very acidic, and they'll often give me heartburn, and after a while I felt lethargic from using them. I know we're not saying that everything's for everybody, But when they're doing those studies, aren't they actually just study, like in wine, aren't they just studying the resveratrol from the grapes? And in chocolate, aren't they just studying the benefits from the specific cacao bean versus all the added sugar that's in it? And when they're doing the coffee, for example, aren't they studying the bean before it's been cooked multiple times before it goes into your system? Are these actual human, like double-blind scientific studies?
They look at 65,000 people over the course of 30 years, and they monitor everything that they report eating, and they look at their health outcomes, and then they dissect the data in a gazillion ways, and they look at what the people who did better had in common, and then they find out what's interesting from these statistics. So, and some of these studies are very, very large, and they involve, again, you know, 60, 70,000 people over the course of many decades. And in those studies, I'm saying that the people who have consumed more red wine, more chocolate, and more coffee, as well as green tea, mushrooms, and greens, all tend to have better health outcomes, statistically. And then you factor in the remarkable reality that for the coffee and chocolate consumers, they're probably consuming sugar and milk with those products, which are known to have an adverse health impact. And I think it makes the data even more compelling. So if they were drinking black coffee or they were drinking unsweetened chocolate, which is not very appealing to most people, they might even have stronger health outcomes, because clearly we know it's not the sugar and the dairy products that are consumed with those things that are beneficial. And we know that in the blue zones, red wine seems to be something that most people in blue zones tend to consume. Not all of them. I don't think the Seventh-day Adventists do. And they drink it socially. But here's the thing. It's possible that people who drink red wine are not drinking vodka or beer. And maybe statistically, it's one or the other for a lot of people. And it may be the absence of vodka or beer that's actually showing the benefit, because alcohol consumption is so widespread. So is red wine truly beneficial compared to no alcohol? We don't entirely know. It's a little harder to break that down. Similarly, I mean, with coffee, I think the question is, are they drinking that instead of Coca-Cola, right? And if that's the case, yeah, probably anything would be better than Coca-Cola or Pepsi or these other soft drinks, right?
Or are they drinking it with almond milk and honey versus white sugar and 2% milk, right?
Well, yeah, well, clearly that's going to be I think we could be pretty clear that's going to be a positive step for most people. But the data is pretty strong that for the population as a whole, you know, and we could see the data that, you know, coffee is going to increase mental function, which is actually good for fighting Alzheimer's and dementia, which is one of the places it shows up the most powerfully. Now, does that mean that everyone should be consuming caffeine on a regular basis? Of course not. You have to listen to your own body and how it affects you as you're doing. And maybe for a lot of people who are on the standard American diet, that extra burst of blood flow to the brain is beneficial. But maybe if you're not clogging your arteries with large amounts of animal products and your diet isn't deficient in fiber, you don't need that extra burst because you're already having lots of circulation, right? So we don't know with a really pristine, healthy diet how these things would play out. But I can say that for the masses of a general population, there's a positive health effect linked to all of these foods.
Well, and so I think what we're really talking about here is finding balance, right? Because somebody could take this information and go, and support the belief system of like, oh, more coffee is good, when they're already drinking 7 cups a day, right? And they're going and justifying that 7 or 8 or 9 cups of coffee a day is good, or same thing for sugar or wine, right?
Right.
They're having 1 or 2 glasses, but they think, oh, I could have 3 or 4, you know, and splurge and all of that. But I think the balance is key, right? Because the other side of that is, if you do have too much caffeine, if you do have too much stimulant, if you are having 3, 4, 5, 6 cups of coffee a day, for example, or, you know, 4 or 5 glasses of wine, you're going to experience some major deficiencies in your kidneys and your adrenals and your overall energy and clarity, because you reach that point where all of a sudden those things stop functioning at their highest potential, and now you are lethargic, you are tired, and you are slow. So I think there's that balance, right? I've spent some time with the Kogi indigenous elders who came here to Santa Fe from the High Sierra Nevada mountains in Colombia, and they basically live like this, 100% on the land for thousands of years, growing their own food. Incredible people, incredibly healthy. They drink coffee, but two things: one, they grow their own coffee beans, and two, they usually start the morning with 1 cup. And that's it. They don't sit and drink 6 or 7 or 8 cups of coffee a day every day. And the ones who maybe do, I'm sure there are a few of them, they are outside exercising all day. They're not sitting in a computer. So I think the key we're talking about here is finding balance, right?
Totally. I agree. And, you know, there are some other superfoods I want to mention. Turmeric is consumed widely in India. It's the most popular spice in India. They consume it pretty much every day in India. And India has approximately 2% the Alzheimer's rate of the United States, the lowest, pretty much the lowest of any country in the world. And there could be any number of reasons for that, but many scientists think that turmeric could be the biggest reason behind that. And also Indians have a much more plant-based diet than Americans do, and there are many other differences as well. But there is a tremendous and growing body of research that indicates that turmeric is an anti-inflammatory and that it is good for brain function and that it's good for cardiovascular health. So more and more people are starting to add turmeric to their spice rack, and it's not the only spice that's beneficial. We find that pepper can be very beneficial. We find that, in fact, there are many spices that are beneficial to health. And what we find is that when you add more spices to your food, you're less inclined to overdose it with sugar, salt, and fat because you get the flavor from another direction. And a lot of us like to have flavor in our food. We don't just want things boring. And spice is a great way to add flavor in a way that's actually good for your health. So those are a few of my favorite kind of superfoods to promote. There are many others. Greens, of course, being very much at the top of the list. I just mentioned it because I figure most people know we need to eat our vegetables. But the data is overwhelming. Particularly like cabbage and, you know, broccoli and kale and collards. I mean, the nutrient profiles are just massive. We get so much fiber. We get so much powerful nutrients, phytonutrients, flavonoids, antioxidants that help fight cancer and fight diabetes and bring down our weight levels and increase our vitality and give our body the resources it needs to perform at a peak level. So I eat a lot of greens. We do in our house. We sometimes will steam a big pot and literally just it's finger food. And sometimes I do it first, and my kids will eat while I'm making dinner. They'll come out, and they're hungry, right? Instead of grabbing a bag of chips or something, they're grabbing the broccoli, and they're just eating it with their hands, you know? And it's great. So by the time we've even started our dinner, we've already chowed down on a whole, you know, couple bunches of broccoli.
Well, I'm glad you brought that up, because the family life is so important right now in teaching our kids good eating habits, right? If we want them to be healthy, we obviously have to lead by example. And I love that you do that for your kids. And, you know, my daughter, she's 6 years old, and she's the most mono eater, picky eater of anybody I've ever met. She won't eat anything we make as a dish that has multiple ingredients in it. You know, she wants to eat everything mono. So some of the things we do for her is like kale. We'll take a couple big heads of or leaves of kale and squeeze some lime juice on it, and then a little bit of salt. And same thing with cabbage, and then just massage it in. And for her, that's really delicious that way, you know, and she's getting her greens that way. But I think, because I've had people ask me, and they say, well, how do I get my kids to eat more vegetables? You have to eat more vegetables, right? That's it. If you don't have the junk in the cupboards where you can easily give them the cookies or give them the bad chips or whatever, and you say, no, here's some kale. Let's dress it up a little bit. Let's make it taste good. You know, the more you do that, the more they are going to eat it. But if you're not doing it yourself, then you can't expect your kids to do it, right?
That's right. Exactly.
So yeah. I want to address a couple of things here. One is, obviously, through the Food Revolution Network, you guys reach hundreds of thousands, probably millions of people now, I'm sure, just you know, expanded globally through the work you do, through the summits that you offer, which I do want to encourage people, take a look at the Food Revolution Summit, because it's an incredible powerhouse of just wisdom and education, information, science, and data, and research that will take you deeper into a lot of these subjects. But I want to bring this to two levels. One, to the personal level. How does it that somebody changing their own personal health, impacting their own personal health, shows up in their community, in their local community, and in the planet as a whole? And why is that important to you?
Well, one of the great lies of our times is that we are fundamentally separate and that we can be happy at the expense of another. And, you know, we have many wisdom traditions down through history that teach us about cause and effect and about consequences, whether you believe in karma, whether you believe in the afterlife, whether you believe in heaven and hell. There's this sense that what you do now and how you impact others is going to come back to you, right? And, you know, all of the world's major faith traditions essentially tell us, treat others as you would have them treat you. Do unto your brother as you would have them do unto you, you know? And so given this reality, it comes as no great surprise to me that when it comes to our relationship to the world around us, when we disconnect and we sort of think it's a dog-eat-dog world and I'd rather, you know, eat dogs than get eaten by dogs, so I'm just going to try and take care of number one, we impoverish ourselves in some way because our hearts are bigger than that. You know, there's a reason why cute pictures of dogs and kittens and puppies like go crazy and viral on Facebook. There's a reason why people love to have their hearts warmed. When we see babies, we go, oh, how cute. It doesn't matter. Like, we don't judge them. We don't criticize them. We don't think about what's wrong with them. We know that everybody fundamentally comes in innocent and pure and deserves love and deserves a fair chance in life. And yet something happens, some kind of disconnect happens when we think that we can be fundamentally well at the expense of another, and we come to accept as a status quo things that are morally unconscionable to us. I'm talking about child slavery and chocolate production, for example. And I didn't mention this when I talked about chocolate, but if you're going to eat chocolate, make it organic and fair trade. Because on the Ivory Coast right now, which is where half the world's cocoa is produced, there is slavery with, you know, tens of thousands of people, many of them children, who are enslaved in chocolate production. This is happening right now in the real world. And if you don't know better, you're participating in that. And you're funding it. Similarly with animals. You know, we have a normalization of cruelty where animals are tortured in factory farms, where chickens can never lift a single wing, and they go crazy because they're in such close quarters, and they try to peck each other to death. So the industry's answer is to cut their beaks off. So they'll still peck, but they can't kill each other. We have cows and pigs that never see a blade of grass in their entire life, that never touch the dirt, that never see the sunshine. They live their whole life on concrete or on slats and, you know, steel cages and the overpowering stench, and where their basic urges are frustrated and where they can never eat their natural diet and they're fed a totally foreign diet. Sometimes they're forced to become cannibals against their will because the bodies of their brothers and sisters are mixed into their feed. And this is so unnatural, and it comes back to haunt us. As our antibiotics are becoming impotent, 80% of the antibiotics used in the United States, 60% in Europe, are used in factory farms. And these are breeding antibiotic-resistant bacteria, which are now rendering the most potent weapons we have in fighting disease impotent. 700,000 people died last year from antibiotic-resistant bacteria. That number is rising fast around the world. We could be looking at a post-antibiotic world within a generation, and factory farms are the absolute number one party to blame for this. So when we treat animals with unimaginable cruelty, we're also destroying the lives of future generations and their ability to fight disease with antibiotics, which are vastly overused, but in their right place can be lifesavers. And so my point here is that what we do has consequence. The choices we make have consequence to other sentient beings and ultimately to us as well. If not personally, then collectively. And I think it is in all of our selfish best interests to have a circle of compassion that grows, to recognize that our wholeness and our aliveness and our dignity as Homo sapiens will be greater when we feel that our lives are in some way of contribution to the world around us. Now, I focus on food. And so I look at food, and I think food is one of those places where we have immense power. When you choose to go cruelty-free and not patronize factory farms, you are helping to shift the course of history for antibiotics, for the environment that those farms are so polluting of, but also for animals and for your own conscience and what you take into your body. When you choose to go with fair trade foods that are paying farmers a living wage and paying farm workers a living wage, you are investing in an ecosystem, in an environment that is more sustainable. You're investing in webs of relationships that feel aligned with your own integrity. When you choose to go organic, you're doing so not just because you don't want to take neurotoxic pesticides into your body, but also because you think that farm workers shouldn't be dying at the average age of 49, which is the average life expectancy in the United States, largely because, among other factors, of pesticide exposure. You're saying, I don't want these poisons to be used in food production. I don't want them sprayed on our land and ending up in our water, which we're drinking, as well as taking it into your body. So it's all connected. When you go cruelty-free, when you go organic, when you go fair trade, these are choices you make that can benefit your health personally, but they also impact our whole planet. And I think that we feel more rich, more alive, more satisfied with ourselves when we know that we're part of the solution instead of part of the problem.
Inspiring words, and I love you broke it into three things: organic, cruelty-free, and fair trade. I mean, obviously you can go deeper and deeper in that, but that as a starting point and a foundation for all of us is huge for personal health and for planetary health. So thank you for sharing that. And in the last minute here, I'd love for you just to address the money factor, because I know so many people that say, well, I would love to do that, but I can't afford it. And I have some ideas on this as well and some experience, but I'd love for you to address that question.
Okay. So a few points on that. Number one, it is a problem. We have a government subsidy system. In the U.S. in the last 20 years, there's been over $300 billion in subsidies that have gone primarily towards junk food. We're subsidizing commodities crops that are making the price of high fructose corn syrup and factory farmed animal products lower. And comparatively, less than 1% of our subsidies have been going to fresh fruits and vegetables. So we're stacking the marketplace. This is marketplace logic in reverse. We're subsidizing junk, and that does make it harder to do the right thing. And add to that that because systems of scale are all going towards junk food, because that's how our economic system is set up around food right now, and it makes it harder to get affordable, accessible food that's high quality and healthy, right? So that is something the consumer faces. But there are some things we can do to turn it around, right? Number one, as an individual, go with less processed, because actually all that processing does add to the price point of foods. And when your body is properly nourished, you also won't need as many calories. The average American gets about 600 more calories than is considered optimal or recommended. And a lot of that is because we're not feeling satisfied.
On bananas, for example, right, between conventional bananas and organic bananas, you're talking often a 10-15 cent difference, right? 66 cents versus 77 cents in a lot of cases versus, right? So you're saying fresh foods because it's going to be a minimal difference in price versus packaged foods, which can be tens or even 20s.
Cooking quantity. Cook on the weekend or whenever you've got some time and make a big thing of something and have it around. Freeze soups in the freezer and pull them out when you need them. Get into food sharing co-ops with other people. This is about time as well as money, right? So, you know, start a food sharing cooperative where at work, you know, a different person brings a healthy meal for a group of five people once every day of the week, and you all share, and you only have to cook once a week instead of 5 days a week, but you got lunch ready to go, and then you're not at the mercy of your cafeteria, right? Those are examples or you can do the same thing with dinners, with neighbors, right? Just create common pools, and it makes it easier to do the right thing. And you also use build stronger social fabric, like carpooling has taken off, and carpool lanes have helped to encourage us in that direction, right? But similarly, I think food sharing and healthy food sharing could take off and do a lot for a lot of the fabric of community. So cooking in quantity, also basing around the simple whole foods, you know, developing a taste and finding ways to spice up simple foods that you like. Because the truth is that legumes, brown rice, you know, cabbage, carrots, onions, button mushrooms, these things are not that expensive. Quinoa even, which can be kind of pricey compared to some other grains. But when you actually look at, to get a 2,000 calorie diet on quinoa, it's about $7, right? It's not a lot. Most people can afford $7 a day. Most people are spending a lot more than that. So I'm not recommending you eat only quinoa. I'm saying that you can look at the math and think about, well, if I got all my calories from this food source, what would that add up to? Legumes are incredibly cheap, you know? And so find ways to enhance them and fix them up that you like, but base your diet around simple, whole, natural foods that are within your budget. And you can save a ton of money. Don't eat out at restaurants much, because they charge a huge premium for the space, for the dishes, for the service, etc., which is their right. But let that be for special occasions, right? For a lot of people, the biggest way they can save money right off the bat is by preparing more of their own food instead of doing takeout or restaurant meals. And obviously that you balance that with time, right? So some of the ways you build that efficiency are by creating habits and lifestyle structures that make it work for you, and get to know some foods you can prepare often that you love. One recipe you really like, that's really healthful and that's affordable to you, and make it once a week, you know, or twice a week even. And you'll get sick of it eventually, but if you do it that often, you can probably last quite a long time, and just have it be part of your starting rotation. And then add another recipe you love, and also get rid of the bad stuff. You know, and step by step, we build habits that we can stay with for a lifetime.
Fantastic. Ocean, thank you so much for your time and wisdom today. I mean, you're a true inspiration for all of us, and it's an honor to have you on the summit.
My pleasure. Thank you so much for doing this. And everybody who's listening right now, thank you for caring, and thank you for putting what you're learning into action.
And wonderful. That's all we have for you all tuning in today. You can learn more about Ocean and the Food Revolution Network, as well as pick up his book at foodrevolution.org. Go grab a copy today. Thank you all for tuning in. I look forward to seeing you on the next interview. Take care.